So we will start at 7.
Yeah, so we have 5 minutes more, I think so.
5 minutes. Ah, Dr. Jason is back. So you can just clarify that quiz with him.
Yes, Dr. Jason. So you would present the quiz.
Yeah. I think.
And then the answer part we will discuss, right? So my only question is that do we have the answer slides also, or you will show the answer slides, the other one, or you send me the mail?
Yeah.
Yeah, sir. Jason, sir, you send me the answer slides as a mail, actually.
Yeah.
Should I have to share the answer slides? No, that you will do it. Ah, fine.
So the answer slides we'll again put
share.
Up.
Again put up. Okay, fine. Got it.
So right. We'll just go through the quiz. Sure. And Johnny will mark the winners.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then we'll answer the quiz.
Okay.
Then you take over and one by one answer. Right. If Shekhar has something to say to your questions also, he can contribute.
Okay.
That way. So both of you will then explain which is the right answer and why.
Right. Okay. Sure.
Have you started putting people in?
Yes.
You have shared your slide, your...
Yeah, it's all checked, sir.
Yeah. So all the best, everybody.
Yeah, same to you. Thanks, sir.
Pleasure.
Pleasure, yeah.
This is our seventh.
Today the participants are a little hesitant to join in the beginning.
People join.
Usually it will be full by now.
Yeah. No, too many. It will come. People will come. We'll start sharp on 7. Huh?
Yes.
Himani is joined. Himani from Delhi. Himani?
Hello, sir.
Hi, Himani. Nice to see you on this.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. It looked very interesting, so I didn't want to miss it.
Yeah, it'll be nice. She's a developmental pediatrician from Delhi.
Okay.
Himani.
Lovely. Very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sir, it's 7.
Yeah, start.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another exciting episode of Pediatric Potpourri, brought to you by Indian Academy of Pediatrics, Cochin Branch, in association with Indian Academy of Pediatrics, Kerala State. Today, we have a very interesting case presentation, followed by discussion by two eminent teachers in their field. And for further proceedings, I invite Dr. Jason. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Pramod. So today is another day of education of the series of the Pediatric Potpourri. And today we have a case which really baffled a lot of people. You know, 1.5 years we went on finding out what this cause of this child's problem was. And therefore we thought that it is a learning exercise for everybody. And therefore this case was selected. And we have Dr. Akbar and Dr. Shekhar Seshadri to discuss this particular case. So we'll start off with Dr. Akbar. Akbar, can you share your slides?
Yeah. One second.
Well, so we're going to talk about a puzzling case of a sleeping beauty. The sleeping beauty. We used to call her the sleeping beauty for quite a while she was in the wards. Next slide, please, Akbar. And so this is Akbar for you. Akbar is a pediatric. Next slide, please, Akbar. Your biotin is.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. So Akbar Mohammed Chetali is a young pediatric neurologist who has taught us a lot of things. He is done his MBBS from Tilpok. He's actually from Chennai. He did his MD from Chipmer, Chandigarh, and did his DM in pediatric neurology under Dr. Shafali Gulati at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. And then came over and joined Aster Medcity Cochin, where created a name for himself because of the way he's been investigating a lot of cases that came into his under his care here. And now he has moved over to the Royal Hospital Ministry of Health, Muscat, Oman, where he's the consultant pediatric neurologist since 2016 May. Well, his field of interest are mitochondrial genetics, developmental epileptic encephalopathy, and autoimmune neurology. Over to you, Akbar, to start the proceeding.
Right. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful introduction. So, good evening, all. It's been a wonderful opportunity from IAP Cochin, and thanks, Jason, sir, for this initiative. Thanks to Corona as well. I mean, it's because of Corona, maybe a year later, and I'm here back, missing my Kerala friends, my colleagues, my teachers, most of my students. So, I'm here this evening to discuss the journey about a child who had seen exactly 3 years before in February 2017. What made the journey or the story of the child interesting was the challenges that she threw upon us, her interesting constellation of signs and symptoms, which made us to think in different aspects of what she could be suffering from. So, my point here, or my duty here, would be to discuss this case in detail. So in two portions, the first step of how we thought about her symptoms and what we investigated and how we reached a diagnosis. And the second part is that how she came up with new symptoms and we have to revisit our diagnosis. So without much ado, I would start presenting this case. So I got a call from ER, that's the emergency room, of Aster Medcity where I was working, about a five-year-old girl. The concerns from the intensivist and the emergency team was that this particular girl did not wake up after going to sleep the same day. So the call came somewhere around 10:30, 11 o'clock. And their concerns were that the child is deeply comatose and that I need to assess her encephalopathy or comatose state, what could be the probable reasons for that, and further guide them regarding management into the intensive care unit. They also tell that this child has been having these episodes of unresponsiveness for the last 4 months. So moving further, once I reach the emergency room and start seeing the child, simultaneously a very quick screening history of the child. So the quick sample history, what we take in an emergency room of what happened and how the symptoms progressed. So the symptoms were very nonspecific. It just said that the child had a dinner. She had more food than usual. She was a little bit irritable and apathetic. And then she went into sleep and then she's been unresponsive ever since. And they tried to wake her up, but she did not wake up for the last 2 to 3 hours. There were no specific allergies. She was not on any regular medications. A past history, as I told you, it was significant that there were like previous 2 to 3 hospitalizations before, with one significant hospitalization in October 2016. That was 4 months before this particular episode. And this was her third episode. She had her last meal 1 hour ago. And the events leading to the hospital is what I just now told, that just she had her food. She never had any fever. She never had any headache. She never had any vomiting or rash or any overt convulsions that the parents could notice upon. And she did not wake up after that particular time because she went into had her food quite early, somewhere around evening 6:30, 7 o'clock. The parents tried to wake her up for the dinner again, and at this point, she did not wake up. So when I had a quick look at her in the emergency, as you can see, I'm trying to assess her. I'm trying to look at her doll's eye movement. I could see a child who was almost limp, almost her breathing efforts, as you can see, was very, very shallow. She was not at all breathing, literally. Her rates were somewhere around 10 per minute to 12 per minute. She was more limp. She was not responding to pain. Her pupils, though, were equal. It was like 3 millimeter. Heart rate was around in the 90s. But breathing was definitely shallow. She was very hypotonic. Right? And again, this is again, I'm trying to check the doll's eye movement, which could give us a clue. Doll's eye movement being restricted is one of the clue of early signs of encephalopathy or coma. Right? Again, in the next slide, you can see that I'm trying to give a very deep pain stimulation for this child, a deep sternal rub. I'm trying to check for the corneal reflex. So the corneal reflex was present. A corneal reflex was present, indicating the brainstem is probably intact. But she had a very deep and a shallow breathing pattern, right? And the reflexes almost was very sluggish. It was very difficult to elicit the reflexes as well. So luckily, one of my student of PG was there with me, and he could take this video at admission so that I could now share with you. So summarizing the examination, the heart rate was 86 per minute regular. The breathing was very shallow, breathing efforts and labored. Saturation was 98 on room air. BP was normal. Initial blood sugar in the emergency room was normal. The temperature was normal. The airway was maintained, but the breathing was affected for sure. And the circulation showed a good perfusion. There was nothing contributory in the physical examination. There was no dysmorphism. There was no skin rash. There was no abdominal odor, no neurocutaneous markers, no pallor, no jaundice. Her GCS was very low. It was only E1, M1, as I had shown in the video before. And she was just making moaning sounds to deep pain. Pupils were equal and reactive. The gag and the corneal reflexes were present. The eyes were divergent. And the doll's eye movements was pretty sluggish. There was no facial asymmetry. There was no pooling of saliva. The uvula was in the midline. The mouth was open. The tone was very much reduced. She was very limp and very flaccid. The reflexes were very sluggish. The meningeal signs were absent. And there was no signs of impending brain herniation. And the rest of the examination was not contributory. At least on examination, it was clear that she was deeply comatose with the hypoventilation. But there was nothing to suggest that she had raised intracranial features, that she was not posturing, she was not having decorticate posturing or decerebrate posturing. There was no meningeal signs. Even historically, there was no history of fever. So with this examination, when we went back to the parents, took a detailed history about what is the story in the emergency room, they said that nothing was suggestive. This child was otherwise having some background speech issues. She had a speech delay. She had some fine motor coordination issues. She used to have some funny movements in the hands, almost like stereotypies. And they were going for rehabilitation centers for speech therapy. And they were told to have probably autism spectrum disorder. There was no adverse perinatal events or birth asphyxia in the past. But then the mothers told that she started having similar episodes, which were very stereotypical, that this child would go on to sleep. Like, for example, the child would be a bit irritable, a bit confused, would have her food and then sleep, and would subsequently be unresponsive for longer duration of period. And this started somewhere around 4 years of age, that is 4 months prior to this particular episode. She had almost like two or three episodes like this, but she had one significant hospitalization for similar episodes where it was documented that this child had probably seizures with vacant stares, and the child received anti-epileptic phenytoin. And for this particular episode, which happened 4 months ago, she was in the pediatric intensive care of the nearby hospital, and she was admitted for 10 days. She was started on phenytoin as a maintenance therapy. She was told to have epilepsy as a diagnosis, and she was asked to continue the medications. One important point was also to be noted was this: once the child was admitted 4 months ago, their MRI, which was done on the past hospitalization, showed features of posterior reversible encephalopathy, that is white matter changes in the part of the brain. And she also had a significant autonomic dysfunction in the last visit with hypertension and intermittent tachycardias and intermittent bradycardias. So this history was probably significant, that why she's been having these episodes for the last 4 months. So here, so just synthesizing, so we had a child who has been unresponsive for like 3 to 4 hours, who came to emergency in a deeply comatose state. She's not responding to deep pain. She's not having any specific toxidrome like pupillary dilatation or pupillary constriction or sympathetic activation. Her heart rates were in the normal range. BPs were in the normal range. She did not have any features of a raised ICT or a meningeal sinus. She never had fever before. So, but she had similar episodes before for the last 4 months. Now, this is the point, and she also had an autism spectrum disorder as a background. So the handles for workup was, what could be the reason for these recurrent bouts of loss of consciousness? Is that an episodic encephalopathy, which is presenting without fever? So likely this is probably the third episode. She would have been having these episodes many times before. What could be the reason for her shallow breathing? Is that a part of generalized autonomic dysfunction is that the child having, or is it a part of the underlying nature itself? Is she having autonomic dysfunction or cardiac arrhythmias from the beginning, which has been occult and which has been missed? Is that the reason? So this was one question or one handle in my mind. She had seizures at the last visit. So am I dealing with the epilepsy syndrome or epilepsy condition where the child has gone on to unwitnessed convulsions? Maybe the parents did not witness a convulsion and subsequently she has gone into this deep state of coma. So am I missing a subclinical convulsion? Am I missing a non-convulsive status epilepticus? This child had an abnormal MRI like 4 months ago. So should I revisit again? Should I look back at the MRI? Is the findings correct at the last visit, or should I think something else? Is that a white matter disease or a rare condition of the white matter which has been missed before? These were the things which were going in my mind. And moreover, when the child has a pre-existing issues, background issues or pre-morbid issues like autism and speech issues, it makes me made me worried more, like probably is that something very complex or very unusual thing that I'm handling in the emergency. So with this thinking process, the major differentials I had to offer for my intensive care team as well as for my team, pediatrics, was that probably I'm handling a child who's having episodic encephalopathy. And every time this child is coming with these episodes where the child goes on to a particular coma and recovers with symptomatic management. So the major groups of differentials I would like to consider would have been an epilepsy, would have been a metabolic conditions, a metabolic encephalopathy, would have been an immune-mediated encephalitis syndromes, or could be rarely genetic causes. So these were the four groups of categories of diseases which were in my mind and which I had intended to work up for the child. So the child was stabilized in the emergency room, was admitted in the intensive care unit. And based upon these differentials, I started evaluating the child. And of this, the priority, of course, is the non-convulsive seizures or coma or the metabolic encephalopathy. So the first two differentials are extremely important, not to be missed, a non-convulsive status child leading on to a child into a deep comatose state. Because if I can recognize a non-convulsive seizures and I can treat them, it could make a difference in the sensorium of the child. So of course, as we all know, as pediatricians being involved with children, metabolic encephalopathies can also present with such varied manifestations and are also needs to be identified at onset. Because if there's a delay in identifying metabolic conditions, it can be harmful for the child. As noted in the emergency room, the child's sugar was normal. So at least one value was normal, and I intended to work upon certain other metabolic conditions which can lead to a coma-like state or a deep encephalopathy like urea cycle defects or any condition which can cause hyperammonemia. We know that this child did not have jaundice or hepatic failure. So apart from an hepatic encephalopathy, the other things which could increase the ammonia would be urea cycle defects presenting as an inborn error of metabolism. Could this be a mitochondrial energy pathway defects where the child having ATP-related pathways defects could easily go on to coma after a trivial stress? Is that an unusual aminoacidopathy like maple syrup urine disease presenting with coma and encephalopathy? Is that a biotinase defect or a thiamine metabolism defects? So these were the differentials at onset, I mean, at outset on day one, probably these were the things which were in my mind. So what happened next? With these differentials, the rationale for workup, as I told, is always that the child had premorbid issues of speech delay and autism disorder, had convulsions, which was documented 4 months ago in the previous hospital. The child had an abnormal MRI in the previous hospital, and there was a presence of autonomic dysfunctions documented in the previous hospital. And also later on, we could also identify autonomic dysfunction at our admission as well. The child had some intermittent bouts of tachycardias and intermittent bouts of high BP records. So all this made me thinking that we need to go evaluate, dig deeper, and try to find out the cause, because the child has already been evaluated at the previous hospital without a specific diagnosis, and the diagnosis being labeled as epilepsy. So the thing in my mind was that I should clarify the diagnosis and I should reach a probable diagnosis for this child. So just to discuss upon the differentials slightly in detail, just to differentiate, and then we'll see what the investigations have done for my child. So non-convulsive seizures as an entity, we as pediatricians involved with children should be aware of. It's important to be aware of. One common situation where a child could have a non-convulsive status epilepticus is when a child had thrown a convulsive seizure. For example, if a child had thrown a convulsive status epilepticus in the ER, let us say for 15 to 20 minutes, and it's admitted in the PICU, and then subsequently, if the child does not recover from the encephalopathy over a period of, let us say, 1 to 2 hours, it has been known that these children could be having a subclinical seizures or electrographic seizures going on in their brain, which is not manifested overtly. So as a part of protocol, our intensivist, pediatric intensivist, and intensivist world over should be aware of the entity of a non-convulsive status, especially if the child had presented with a convulsive status epilepticus, and if the child does not recover from the encephalopathy as expected after you give, like, let us say, phenytoin and midazolam. So this is a common scenario. But apart from this common scenario, why I say this is that because a non-convulsive status epilepticus is actually a missed diagnose, or it's a underdiagnosed in many children as well as in many adults who continue to have subtle dysfunctions after a particular convulsion episode. So they may have all sorts of dysfunction because of a subclinical seizures or electrographical seizures. As you know, that the seizures arise from the cerebral cortex, and they can involve various lobar functions like frontal lobe and temporal lobe, your insular lobe, your autonomic functions, your occipital lobe, and so on. So they can present with a varied manifestation that can be very variable. For example, we can have temporary bouts of aphasia. There can be temporary bouts of amnesia. There can be temporary bouts of dysarthria. In fact, to that extent, sometimes non-convulsive seizures or electrographic seizures can produce temporary breathing abnormalities, temporary autonomic dysfunctions, intermittent runs of tachycardia, intermittent bradycardias, intermittent apneas, and so on. So in a child who is comatose, probably the standard of care should be to use a continuous EEG so that we do not miss a non-convulsive status. It's very, very important. And EEG monitoring should be mandatory so that we don't miss that. There are specific criteria for that, and any cognitive impairment or any sensorial impairment which goes on for more than 30 minutes with continuous electrographic activity of more than 2.5 hertz in the runs as an evolving rhythm, I'm not going into the technical details seen in an EEG, would suggest that there is a probably non-convulsive seizures. The most important point in a non-convulsive seizure is that whenever I say non-convulsive seizures, automatically, the term itself means that you don't see overt convulsions like tonic-clonic seizures or tonic seizures. But having said that, in a non-convulsive convulsions, sometimes you can see very subtle manifestations like subtle myoclonic movements, subtle twitches, subtle muscle fasciculation movements, subtle eye movements, like subtle spontaneous nystagmus-like movements, okay, subtle disconjugate eye movements, and so on and so on. So the motor movements can be so subtle that it could be missed. So interestingly, I would just like to tell that I saw a child recently who had this bouts of aphasia for like 10 to 15 days and then would recover from that, and again would have bouts of aphasia or speech difficulty for 10 to 15 days and would recover. So it was very difficult for us to understand what is happening. And only thing she had was small twitches around the mouth, around the lips. And when we did an EEG, that was a continuous electrographic seizures going on, producing only small twitches around the mouth. So your motor manifestations can be very subtle. So these sort of subtle motor manifestations should always be checked in a comatose child. So for our index case, if you go back, the girl who had admitted in ER did not have intermittent myoclonic twitches or did not have intermittent nystagmus or disconjugated eye movements or apnea or hypoventilation, but she definitely had some shallow ventilation, some change in the heart rate rhythms and the BP. So this was one thing about non-convulsive seizures. So I had put a continuous EEG monitor in this child. So the second differential is, of course, metabolic encephalopathy. This would be really out of scope of this discussion today to talk about metabolic encephalopathy in detail or inborn errors of metabolism in detail in children. Time and again, we have been surprised by how children can present with unusual manifestations, and it could turn out to be some neurometabolic condition, right? So neurometabolic condition is so variable in terms of the symptoms and in terms of the manifestations, okay? And it is very well known to produce a fluctuating sensorium or a fluctuating cognition, a fluctuating neurological signs. So whenever we see this bouts of fluctuation in a children, one of the things that we should suspect as pediatrician is an inborn error of metabolism. So even adults can have, even those without comorbid illness can have. And as we know that the spectrum is huge, you can have small molecule disorders like fatty acid oxidation defect, glucose pathways related defect like gluconeogenesis defects, or you can have urea cycle disorders or amino acidopathies, or you can have large molecule defects. So generally those small molecule defects like urea, the mitochondrial energy transfer mechanism, okay, the vitamins like thiamine and biotin, which plays a part in the energy cycle, and the amino acid pathways, these are the ones which can present with intermittent fluctuating encephalopathy. But having said this, these children always do have some clues from the beginning. For example, if the child had a urea cycle disorder, one of the clues is that the child would be naturally be aversive to protein eating foods like eggs or chicken or fish. The child would tend to avoid it. The child may have intermittent vomiting episodes to high protein diet. The child may naturally avoid such proteinaceous food. And there may be another clues if it's a mitochondrial spectrum. For example, the child may have a failure to thrive. The child may have recurrent migraine-like headache episodes. The child may have a short stature. The child may have a droopy eyelids. The child may have very easy fatigability. So there are a lot of clues for these children. They have some subtle dysfunctions right from the beginning till the point that their energy pathways or their metabolic pathways gets decompensated. And that is the time when they come and present to us in emergency, right? But it is highly variable. You can have a severe inborn error of metabolism presenting in the newborn period versus a mild inborn error of metabolism which presents even in an adult. So it is important to identify the treatable inborn errors of IEM at the outset. So I should repeat this sentence again. The treatable inborn errors of metabolism are very, very important to be identified. I remember as a resident, when I was doing my pediatric training, I had a child who had that unexplained, similar like this unexplained bout of coma with a mild global developmental delay. And this child rapidly decompensated in the hospital within first 24 to 48 hours. And the child was being evaluated for meningoencephalitis and ADAM and so on and so. But one of the possibility that we missed in the child was a biotin defect, okay? And the child's postmortem samples, when we sent, the samples that before the child expired, it was highly deficient of biotidinase level. So if you had started this biotin tablets in this child, probably we could have saved the child. So this was an important lesson during my residency that I would never forget about that particular child. So treatable IEMs like biotidinase deficiency, like thiamine metabolism defects, like cobalamin vitamin defects, if there is an hyperammonemia, you should aggressively treat it to the point that sometimes even dialysis is required. Those treatable IEMs should never be missed at outset. So these two differentials, non-convulsive seizures and metabolic encephalopathy, were always my most important differentials. Then, of course, comes about the rarer ones, still rarer ones. As you might be aware that we are seeing a lot of children who present with encephalopathy who have immune-mediated syndromes, syndromes because of immune dysfunction. The common ones all of us know is an immune-mediated dysfunction which can cause demyelination in the brain, which we know as ADAM, that is acute disseminated encephalomyelitis. I'm sure as pediatricians, we are aware of ADAM when we see a child with encephalopathy or raised ICT or convulsions. And when we do an MRI, there are white matter changes. And it's a clinical radiological EC diagnosis when there is an abnormal MRI with an abnormal child. But you can also have immune-mediated syndromes with absolutely normal MRIs. And one of the commonest immune-mediated syndromes that we see in children is NMDA receptor encephalitis. It is as common, sometimes even more common than herpes encephalitis. One of the cohort studies says that an NMDA receptor encephalitis is the second common encephalitis after ADAM, that is acute disseminated encephalomyelitis. So ADAMs can present sometimes with unusual movement disorders, unusual autonomic dysfunction or your NMDA receptor encephalitis can present with autonomic dysfunction, central hypoventilation, so on. So, but usually it happens in the late stage of the disease and not in the early stage of the disease. So when this child presented with a shallow breathing pattern and with a shallow breathing efforts with some autonomic dysfunction, one of the possibility was also probably is that an NMDA receptor encephalitis. But I also thought about another condition which is also equally interesting in producing encephalopathy in children, that is endomospectrum disorders. So if at all I have immune mediated differentials in a child, the four differentials that I would think in a child presenting with encephalopathy, and if it is an immune, I would think about four main rings. The first one would always be NMDA receptor encephalitis. The second, I would think about, of course, ADAM. And the third, I would think about a new entity known as MOG, that is myelin oligodendrocyte glycoprotein antibody, which can also present with encephalitis. And the fourth one is this neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorders or NMOSD disorders. It's interesting because whenever we say neuromyelitis optica, the classical the definition of the Devic's disease or Devic's syndrome is a child who has a long segment transverse myelitis with loss of vision, who becomes blind, that is optic neuritis. So the combination of optic neuritis with a long segment transverse myelitis, we think about neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorders. That is the classical ones. But when we go interestingly for the, let us say for the last 5 to 6 years, there have been more than that, there have been interesting manifestations because these immune conditions typically involve the astrocytes, and those astrocytes typically affect close to the third ventricle and the hypothalamic and the thalamic region. And right from the hypothalamic thalamic region, they can involve your entire spinal cord. And sometimes it can involve cerebellum and portions of the brain as well. So neuromyelitis optica, from the initial description of just transverse myelitis and optic neuritis, has been now expanded to involve four more core deficits. And these four more core deficits are based upon the findings that this NMO antibody can also damage your hypothalamus, your thalamus, and your brainstem. So the four deficits that we could see in NMO spectrum are the brainstem syndrome. If it affects the medulla, there can be multiple cranial nerve palsies. We can have number two, the area postrema syndrome. So area postrema is the area which is a divide of the blood barrier close to the third ventricle. And if the area postrema is involved, the children can very interestingly present with intractable vomiting and hiccups. So there have been case reports where NMOSD children has been admitted in pediatric gastroenterology wards and gastroenterology department because of intractable vomiting, and later on found to have a demyelinating disorder, that is NMOSD. And if your lesions involve hypothalamus and the thalamus, we can have what is known as a diencephalon syndrome. So this is again interesting. I saw a child in Aster Medicity who just present with sudden onset obesity and behavioral changes. And he had a small lesions in the hypothalamus and he had a NMOSD antibody positive and he responded to steroids and IVIG. So if the lesions are in the hypothalamus and the thalamus, they can present with really funny syndromes like endocrine dysfunction. They can present with brainstem dysfunction. Okay. And the last and the important manifestation of NMOSD is that if it involves the white matter and the cerebral cortex, they can also present with status epilepticus, convulsions, and encephalopathy. So as I try to explain here, immune-mediated disorders are also extremely wide and variable in presentation. The common ones in children, of course, is ADAM and NMDA receptor encephalitis, but rarely NMOSD spectrum disorders involving your brainstem or hypothalamus or thalamus can also present with unusual syndromes. So probably when this child presented with to my ER and over the period of course, I thought probably we should also work up for immune mediated spectrum disorders. It's very important because immune mediated disorders are also amenable to therapy. Therapeutic options are available in form of steroids, IVIG, rituximab, plasmapheresis. Immunomodulatory agents are always available. So unless we search for these antibodies, it is likely that we can miss a NMO spectrum disorder. And the last, but not the least, I thought probably, is there a rare genetic predisposition in this child? This child is already having a global delay, some speech issues, some autism spectrum disorder. So is that a rare channelopathy? Now, whenever I say channelopathies, for one, we are not, if you're not used to this term, channelopathies, we may not be knowing what are channelopathies. So channelopathies are nothing but episodic events. Like, for example, when I say epilepsy, epilepsy is also channelopathy. Epilepsy also involves ion channels in the brain. And so the symptoms which presents as convulsions. Likewise, you can have the channels in the brain or in the muscle or in the heart or in the endocrine glands. And these channels are usually sodium channels, potassium channels, calcium channels, chloride channels, or acetylcholine channels, etc. And if these channels, you know, and if the transfer of ions across these channels are affected, they can present with episodic manifestations. I mean, if I want to tell in a simple form, one of the episodic muscle channelopathy we all know is myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis are fluctuating weakness. Okay, they are normal in the morning hours, but by evening they become weak, and because they have fatigability and exercise intolerance. Likewise, we can have other muscle channelopathies like myotonia, where there is an episodic stiffness of the muscle. So channelopathies are always kept as differential when you have unexplained episodic events. So one of the closest differential to an epilepsy is always a channelopathy. So I had a very interesting channelopathy in Aster who was thought to about to have epilepsy disorder, but it was actually a pain channelopathy. The child was presenting with pain attacks episodically, right? So channelopathies can surprise you. It has surprised me many times. Even here in Oman, I was surprised when a child presented with ataxia, which looked like neuroblastoma related ataxia, opsoclonus myoclonus ataxia, but it turned out to be episodic ataxia type 6. So there are many channelopathies which can present with episodic symptoms, and these episodic symptoms can be either weakness or a movement disorder like ataxia, a movement disorder like a chorea, or it can be even unusual autonomic symptoms. Okay, you can present like an episodic headache. Okay, and there are interesting channelopathies which can present with episodic coma. The most important are the mitochondrial related, ATP related channelopathies, which can also have a migraine as one of the clue. The families can have run migraine, and one of them can present with severe episodic encephalopathy or coma with weakness, and the weakness can alternate the sites. So to emphasize this for this point again, so whenever I see an episodic events, I should think about one of the rare possibility and the genetic possibilities are always channelopathies involving the brain, the muscle, or the heart. So because this child had recurrent episodic events of deep encephalopathy and coma, one of the rare possibility I also wanted to evaluate was for the genetic channelopathy. So here I mentioned about two cases, like we had a familial hemiplegic migraine presenting as encephalopathy, and encephalopathy secondary to sodium channel mutation. So these were my four important differentials. Is that a non-convulsive status epilepticus? Am I missing an inborn error of metabolism? Is there an autoimmune encephalitis or a demyelinating syndrome that I'm missing, or is that a channelopathy? With these differentials, we started stabilizing the child. The child was stabilized in the intensive care unit. IV fluids were started, oxygen were given, right? Empirically, the child was started on intravenous immunoglobulin after sending blood workup and the lumbar puncture. So the lumbar puncture CSF study was essentially normal. The cells were acellular, the protein was normal, the sugar was normal. The CSF cultures was normal. The CSF viral panel PCR study was normal. We repeated the brain MRI, and the brain MRI was normal as well. So we looked for the ammonia. The ammonia at admission was mildly elevated. Our cutoff was 90, but it was like 127. It was not very much elevated, and subsequent values were also normal, but it was a little bit mildly elevated. So probably that excited me. Maybe it is an IEM. The serum sodium at admission was 124 milliequivalents. So hyponatremia was corrected. She had a mild acidosis, not very severe enough. Her lactates were normal. Her blood sugar were normal. Her urine ketones were negative. So these compromised your initial part of your evaluation, where we did the routine, the cultures, the counts, the liver function test, the renal function test, and so on. And specifically because I do not want to miss a biotinidase deficiency because it's treatable. Empirically, the child was also put on biotin and the biotinidase levels were sent, which was normal. CSF autoimmune panel was paraneoplastics panel and enoma panel was sent to Amrita Institute, which came as negative. The continuous EEG done did not show non-convulsive status epilepticus. It is just to show a mild slowing of background with large amplitude delta waves, which was very non-specific. It just meant that the child is mildly encephalopathic. The urine organic acids were normal. Right, so this with this evaluation, the child being managed on intravenous immunoglobulin, the child continued to remain deeply drowsy, very minimally responding to painful stimulation, slightly moaning to pain. But by day four, there was some partial recovery of sensorium. The child was still very much drowsy. There was no overt convulsions. So we did not go actively behind any anti-epileptics. At this point, when I felt that the child seems to be more like drowsy rather than being comatose, because with pain, she used to move and turn and, you know, sometimes cry and then again go back to a sleep-like state. When we started discussing with the parents, they said, yes, there is a history of psychiatric illness in the late maternal grandmother, that is the mother's mother, who had been on medication and she used to sleep for long hours and she also died at a relatively younger age. All right. So this history was told by the parents. So at this point, I thought probably I should look at a different way. I should see the things in a different way and should also consider one particular spectrum of unusual sleep in this child and should think in that way as well. So at this point, the EEG was also not suggestive. There was no non-convulsive seizure. So I thought I should go ahead with a polysomnography. So I did a polysomnography at this particular point of time. Now, for those we are not aware, polysomnography is a sleep study where we have multiple sensors for the brain, for the muscles over the chin and for the over the eyes. And we look at the activity of the brain, which is nothing almost like EEG, where we see the different states of the sleep. There are certain clues. For example, if the child is like deeply sleeping, you will have a slow delta waves. And if the child is in a light sleep, you have a fast activity in the EEG of the polysomnography. We can put sensors over the chest wall leads. We can assess the breath flow, how it is, whether the flow is normal or not, whether there is apnea. And there is cardiac monitoring with the ECG and a saturation probe. So polysomnography is nothing but multimodal physiological monitoring. You monitor many things. You monitor the heart. You monitor the brain with EEG. You monitor the muscles with electromyography, that is EMG. And with this multiple physiological variables, you come to a conclusion that how was the sleep. So it gives a very good idea about the total sleep duration, how long is the sleep duration from the beginning to the end, and what happens to the sleep in phases. So is the sleep changing from a normal pattern? Like, for example, all of us, when we sleep and then our sleep goes through the NREM phases, that is non-rapid eye movement phases, and slowly towards the early morning our rapid eye movement phases increases. That is a phase when we start dreaming more. So that's the normal sleep architecture. But in this child, the sleep architecture was not present, was not intact. It was predominantly slow phase. There was almost absent to very much reduced REM phase. Now, polysomnography can help us in diagnostic of certain conditions, especially if you have multiple sleep awakenings, especially if there is more apneas. It is very useful in identifying obstructive sleep apneas. When you can correlate your, you know, sleep chest wall movement along with your saturation index. But in certain conditions, it is suggestive. So in my child, it was suggesting that this child is in a very deep phase of sleep with a reduced REM phase. And there was no bouts of apnea or desaturation. So again, polysomnography made me think and made me suggest that probably it's a type of a deep sleep phase or a deep sleep disorder where the child is in a deep phase. And that gave me the confidence to start mood stabilizers and like divalproic sodium and stimulants like modafinil. With this intervention, the child started awakening by the 7th or the 8th day, and which probably made me think, is that a central sleep disorder? Is that more of a sleep rather than because of encephalopathy? So going back and then seeing my own differentials and looking at the investigations, the CSF was negative. There was no infection. There was no meningoencephalitis. The MRI is normal. There is a bit of autonomic dysfunction. I had to revise my own diagnosis. So this is the point that I thought probably this is a central hypersomnolence disorder, because the polysomnography is here suggesting that there is a deep phase of sleep and this with a disturbed sleep architecture. So with the history, going back again and discussing with the parents, they were like more categorical. They were telling, yes, doctor, these episodes are always stereotypical. The child will become apathetic, will become a bit confused, sometimes will become irritable, and then the child would go on to sleep and the child would never get up. So some of the central hypersomnolence disorders that we see in adults, very rarely in children, include narcolepsy. So narcolepsy is a condition where there is excessive sleepiness in the daytime, where you know that the person can have difficulty in driving a car, where they can go on to sleep multiple episodes in a day. So narcolepsy probably is more common in adults, but I have seen young teenagers and adolescents presenting with narcolepsy. And the other sleep disorders include idiopathic hypersomnias, menstrual hypersomnias, and so on. Hypersomnolence disorders can also be part of encephalitis, like NMDA receptor encephalitis and autoimmune encephalitis. So before telling that it is a central hypersomnolence disorder, we should be reasonably ruling out other autoimmune or infectious causes. So when I went back to the history of this child going to the sleep and being in the sleep state for like 5 days, 6 days, and 7 days, and then waking up with irritability. And interestingly, we also noticed that the child was having bouts of feeding and more apathy and irritability after the child was waking up on day 6 and day 7. I thought probably this could be an unusual syndrome because of unusual presentation. And clinically, we thought most likely this child could have a condition called as Klein-Levine syndrome. So what is this Klein-Levine syndrome? And even the criteria for this child was fitting. I'll be discussing that. So what is this Klein-Levine syndrome? So Klein-Levine syndrome is a central hypersomnolence syndrome, which is classically seen in teenagers. The one way to remember is the rule of 15, like a teenager who is 15 years of age, having more than 15 hours of sleep in a day, continuously for almost like 15 days. And these sleep episodes can occur or recur monthly or 2 monthly or 3 monthly for a period of around 15 years. So one way to remember is an easy clinical description of the rule of 15 in the Klein-Levine syndrome. So Klein-Levine syndrome is an unusual sleep hypersomnolence, a rare hypersomnolence syndrome, which was mentioned in the early 19th century. It was supposed to have a triad of a hypersomnolence, hyperphagia, and hypersexuality. Hypersomnolence, hyperphagia, and hypersexuality. But all those recent studies and systematic reviews, we have come to know that all these three things are not seen in all the patients. So all these three things together are seen in only about 50% or half of the patients of having both hypersomnolence, hyperphagia, and hypersomnolence. So, but it's a classical syndrome seen in young teenagers. So the age group is somewhere between 10 to 20 years. So children less than 10 years are rare, but are definitely reported in literature. There are many children with autistic spectrum disorder mentioned with having Klein-Levine syndrome. There is the youngest reported in the world having Klein-Levine syndrome is a 4-year-old child from China. And the oldest mentioned person suffering from Klein-Levine syndrome was a person who was 82 years of age. And it is a clinical diagnosis. It's a diagnosis of exclusion. We should reasonably exclude encephalitis, drug issues, metabolic disorders, medications, psychiatric illness, or neurological illness like encephalitis, ADAM, or demyelination before coming to a conclusion it is a Klein-Levine syndrome. So at this point, reasonably, we had excluded all these differentials in our child, including infections, metabolic, and this looked likely because by definition, it is like 2 or more episodes. Our child had already around 3 to 4 episodes of excessive sleepiness persisting at least for 2 days to 5 weeks. So the usual mean duration of this episodes are usually around 12 to 15 days, right? So can you
see? No, I can't see your slides.
I don't know what happened. I'll again continue.
No, your slides are.
Right, I'll start again, sir. I don't know what happened. I'll share screen again. Now is it seen, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah, fine. So these are at least two episodes of excessive sleepiness or sleep duration. The average duration is around 12 to 15 days, and sleeping for more than 15 to 20 hours a day. So these children, during the episodes, they don't like to be waken up. They're extremely grumpy. They can have episodes of confusion, episodes of irritability, and they can have bouts of hyperphagia. The episodes should occur at least more than once a year. In between the episodes, the child has a normal cognition, behavior, and normal alertness. And the child can have at least one of the following of altered perception, which our child seems to have, and altered eating habits like hyperphagia or anorexia, and sometimes disinhibited behavior could be like hypersexuality, and it should not be explained by other disorders. So these were the features of Klein-Levine syndrome, which we thought were fitting, which we felt was definitely fitting in our child. So as I told, these children is seen somewhere between 10 to 20 years, but it's extremely rare in children less than 10 years and rare in children more than 20 years. The common age is usually the teenage years. This child also, after starting medicines, had reasonable improvement in symptoms with mood stabilizers and stimulants. Okay, so with this differentials, we had put our child, and yes, there have been reports of Klein-Levine being mentioned in children with autism, and other review also says about pediatric cases of Klein-Levine syndrome being mentioned, though it is rare. So with this, we had started the child on a mood stabilizer. We involved the psychiatry department. Our psychiatrist came and saw the child, and they also felt probably, yes, it is fitting into like a sleep syndrome, because the child is having this bouts of somnolence with waking up after a long period of time. And interestingly, even autonomic dysfunction is being mentioned, and regressive behaviors has been mentioned with Klein-Levine syndrome. So what made us believe that it could be Klein-Levine syndrome is that Klein-Levine syndrome, if you go back to history, some of them can also have global development delays and autistic features and autonomic dysfunction and so on and so on. Okay, so with our psychiatric team, when we had discussion, we all felt together probably this is a sleep disorder, and we had started the child on stimulants like methylphenidate, modafinil, clonidine was started for autonomic dysfunction, divalproic sodium was started for mood disorder. With this, there was definitely improvement in alertness, but the speech part did not improve. Subsequently, the child had few admissions from the point of admission, that is from February, we discharged the child, but the child again used to come with these spells of somnolence. But this time the spells of somnolence was not long like before. It never used to last for 4 to 5 days. In the hospital, it used to recover within 1 or 2 days, or sometimes maximum 3 days. And once she came with an unusual symptom of epistaxis also, we thought whether it is secondary to valparin-induced thrombocytopenia. We checked the platelets, but the platelets were normal. So she was having these visits almost every month to the hospital. And because of this label of unusual sleep disorder, we did not want to restrict or close our diagnosis. We want to keep our diagnosis open. So we thought a genetic study would be useful. And at this point, we also sent a whole exome study, which came as a negative. So the whole exome was not contributory. The gene causes was negative, right? So, yes, sir. So this is the first part of what we saw. And I think, yes, sir, Dr. Jason. So what happened subsequently?
Thank you so much, Dr. Akbar. It was a fantastic explanation of what happened to this child, how we investigated this child. The problem is, for 1.5 years, this child has been diagnosed as a sleep disorder. And the possibility of a child, once it's labeled as the particular this syndrome, then the chances are that the subsequent admissions be taken as for granted. But here, every admission, this child was being reevaluated to see if there's any other cause. And that is what helped us. The child got admitted again for epistaxis once. And that time also the evaluation took place, and we could not find the cause. And the stimulants were continued till she got admitted the next time. And I request Dr. Akbar to carry on with the last admission 1.5 years after the first diagnosis.
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Dr. Jason, sir. So as told by Dr. Jason rightly, that this child, we had a labeled diagnosis of a central sleep disorder, but this child continued to have eventful further visits to hospital. The child used to come with a brief somnolence episodes, and once she presented with an epistaxis, which I thought may be secondary to valparin. So just a brief one slide as a crux of what we had seen from February to July. So with this background of speech delay, autism spectrum, and with past history of seizures, press, with history of 2 to 3 episodes before, we had managed this child. As I told you, we had done EEG, we had done polysomnography, we had sent genetic studies, we had sent autoimmune workup, which was negative. This child had 3 mild episodes subsequently. But the episodes were not there in June, but she came with an epistaxis. So at this point, I thought probably in addition to Valparin, we should start lamotrigine for the child for the mood disorder, because there were intermittent bouts of irritability were still present. So in June 2017, I explained to the parents that I'll be adding lamotrigine along with your sodium valproate. But because lamotrigine with sodium valproate is usually very slowly escalated, and there is always a risk for Steven Johnson's or any type of skin rash. So you need to be very watchful for this skin rash. And if there is any skin rash or any type of allergy, you need to come and report to us early. So this was the discharge advice that I had done when this child was admitted with this epistaxis episode. And interestingly, 7 days later, the child came back again for new admission when this child had new onset skin blisters noted all over the trunk and the exposed areas of the limbs, like the hands and the legs. So we took a dermatology opinion, okay? And when they saw at this point, they thought, yes, it is probably lamotrigine is the inciting agent because it was started recently. We should stop lamotrigine. So we started like skin cares. We stopped lamotrigine. We gave oral steroids. We give skin topical agents, right? And we told this child needs to be followed up regularly. Okay. So with this point, we sent her home, stopping lamotrigine. But then again, she came back a month later, or like 2 to 3 weeks later, that is in July, with new onset lesions. And at this point in July, it was really an eye-opener for all of us. So because we started seeing something new. So after stopping, this child present with increasing skin lesions with much more severe drowsiness and more hypersomnolence pill. Here, the skin lesion looked quite unusual. And I will show the skin lesions. So here we could see those skin lesions, like which were blisters, but it at outset it looked like almost like a target lesions with blisters in the periphery, right? There were multiple lesions in the trunk, in the back, and in the exposed skin areas, including the face. But a close look at that, these were like looked like those something which has been pressed upon the child, and this had a typical image. So our skin Dr. Anuradha, she was very observant. And she was very helpful for us to say that these are very unusual lesions. This doesn't look like typical skin lesions secondary to your lamotrigine or any drug. So this is the point which really made us worry. And when she went back and she told, this probably looks like a cigarette lighter, a cigarette lighter which has been pressed upon hardly upon the child's skin. So these are most likely burns in the skin which are causing these types of rashes. So this is the point we thought there is something unusual, right? And it was obvious at this point that this is probably inflicted non-accidental skin injuries. And at this point, I involved my senior pediatric consultant, our late Dr. Alexander sir and Jason sir and the team and other members were told that we need to be careful for these parents. Maybe there's some sort of an abuse that is going on. The CCTV was installed in our ward to look for any suspicious behavior, and the parents were supervised. And a team of members, a team of members of psychiatrists and skin were involved. Interestingly, the child had another second bout of somnolence in the hospital. So she seemed to recover from somnolence, but then again, she went into a deep somnolence spell. At this point, we sent a urine toxicology and a blood analysis was done. So here we were. It was interesting that we could see our drugs, lamotrigine, clonidine, and methylphenidate, but we saw alcohol in the urine and in the blood. So alcohol was seen both in the urine and in the blood. So we had to go confront the parents, different members, our senior doctor, late Alexander sir, and a psychiatrist, and the skin doctor, everybody had to involve the parents, multiple discussions, and they had subtle admissions that yes, they were drugging the child intermittently with alcohol, probably through the NG tube feeding, but because the child was somnolence, we used to put NG tube feeds, and that gave us the opportunity to give probably alcohol mixed with the feeds or milk, even in the hospital. And that sort of prolonged the somnolence episode. Right? Right. So the final diagnosis here, interestingly, is Munchausen by proxy. So here at this point, multidisciplinary care was initiated. The parents was counseled. Your social welfare team was involved. The medical legal formalities were initiated. Child protection measures were initiated. Subsequently, the child was alert, of course, but there were only very few follow-ups later. They were lost to follow-up. So this is the story that we had seen through.
Thank you, Dr. Akbar.
That would, come. Yeah. So there were like a lot of important message personally for me. Like one of the way as a clinician that we need to think is always, yes, that's the principle of Occam's razor, where we need to think about common things first. Sometimes it is the unusual manifestation of a common disease could be common. That's the principle of Occam's razor. We need to keep all common possibilities in our mind, rule out one by one, before concluding that whether this is an unusual or an uncommon cause. So I remember my own teacher was a psychiatrist. I was keenly interested in psychiatry during my MBBS time. So my psychiatrist, Dr. Balakrishnan, he used to always say in classes that for every psychiatric illness, you should think about an organic illness or a medical illness. And for every medical illness, you should think about a psychiatric illness. And looking back now after so many years, he was very right in thinking for this child, thinking about so many organic causes from autoimmune to metabolic to epilepsy, we should also think about an underlying psychiatric predisposition or a toxin which could have predisposed for this particular organic-like or unusual encephalopathy-like manifestation in this child. So this is the learning point that I had. Luckily for us and luckily for the kid as well, that probably we were able to identify this child over a period of 6 months. Not 1.5 years, sir. It's like around 6 months, February to July. Yeah. Okay, sir. Thanks, sir. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Akbar, for that very, very good presentation and differential diagnosis of this case with hypersomnolism. And we now had a diagnosis of Munchausen syndrome by proxy. And I now invite Dr. Shekhar Seshadri to unshare your...
Sorry. Yeah. I did not stop my screen.
No.
I need to. Okay, fine.
Yeah. Very well presented, Akbar. It was excellent presentation of a very, very difficult problem because we'd come to some sort of a diagnosis and then we were stuck.
We have to rewind the diagnosis.
Rewind the diagnosis, but it's a beautiful. But I think we should make a. It's still not. It's still you're sharing your slides.
So I'll do that 1 second. Yeah. Now it's clear, sir. Fine.
Yeah. Now it's clear.
Fine.
So now we'll have Dr. Shekhar. Shekhar, please share your slides, please. So now we have a diagnosis on this child, and that was Munchausen syndrome by proxy. And who better than Dr. Shekhar Seshadri to explain what this thing is all about? Something that pediatricians need to know a lot, because there are a lot of psychiatric illnesses that pediatricians pick up and don't pick up actually in their practice. And it's often missed. Many of these, this child took us for a ride for nearly 6 months. And next slide, please, Shekhar. And all of you know Shekhar Seshadri. Shekhar is a graduate from the Maulana Azad Medical College, Delhi, and a postgraduate in psychiatry from the NIMHANS, Bangalore. He's currently the senior professor in Department of Child and Adults in Psychiatry and associate dean of behavioral sciences, NIMHANS, Bangalore. And he's somebody that we've been always associated with. We have a problem with child psychiatry, we always try and get to him. And he is working with children and adults in mental health, including developmental disabilities. He's actively involved in gender and sexuality, violence and trauma and abuse of children in difficult circumstances. He's involved in juvenile justice system, experimental methodologies, school programs. So every time we talk to him, there's something new he's doing. So it's something that we learn every time we talk to Dr. Shekhar. There's something that you pick up. He does teacher training in life education, community and community school mental health programs. So he is somebody that we're going to listen to get to know what all this is about, Munchausen syndrome by proxy. Over to you, Shekhar.
Thank you very much, Jason. And Dr. Akbar, absolutely fascinating and scholarly presentation in the true tradition of Kilpok and PGI Chandigarh and All India Institute, Delhi. I'm sure your teachers and colleagues will be proud of the phenomenal scholarship and extent of and the details that you have presented. Before I get to the substantive portion of what I want to share with you, I want to draw a couple of strands from the presentation that Dr. Akbar has made and presented for your consideration. I say this because the Indian Academy of Pediatrics has been particularly interested in the whole issue of child abuse. In fact, with the presence of iCancer, which is a group of the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, and also the Indian Child Protection Medical Professionals Network, which is also an initiative of the iCancer group, where different medical professionals, gynecology, forensics, psychiatrists, pediatricians together form a network with collaboration with international professionals and agencies to really look at the broad and complex spectrum of child abuse. I want to start with one particular issue because Akbar very interestingly presented it towards the end of his presentation, and it was almost a revelation. Many of you may be familiar with the Muzaffarpur case, child care institution, 47 girls systematically sexually abused by the staff of the institution, any random person who walked in and out over a period of 2 to 3 years. The Supreme Court instructed NIMHANS to assist. The case was taken away from the Bihar police and handed over to CBI, and the Supreme Court instructed us to assist the CBI in the investigation. We conducted the investigation and so on. For many of these girls, the abuse was done in a manner which is now referred to in child sexual abuse literature as drug-assisted abuse. And one of the things, unfortunately, that had not been done when the preliminary medical examination was done was a urine and blood toxicology. And this is the revelation, you know, that Akbar has made. If the toxicology had been done at that point of time and it had been found with those girls, that there was presence of benzodiazepines and other such sedatives in the urine, then it would have strengthened the case then. The second point that I want to make before I go into the substance of what I want to share with you is the interesting combination in this case of whatever the clinical complexities were with a child who was a special needs child. And as pediatricians, we need to keep this in mind. Children with developmental disabilities, intellectual disability, autism, or a combination, run the risk of abuse substantially more than neurotypical children. And this is something we need to keep in mind. The third interesting issue that Akbar has raised is the whole differential diagnosis of children who have neurodevelopmental disorders, of which autism is one. And if you add to neurodevelopmental disorders the whole set of conditions that he has spoken about, urea cycle disorder, mitochondrial and ATP defects, maple syrup disease, biotinidase defects, thymine metabolism defects, genetic channelopathies, the neuromyelitis optica, and the various autoimmune encephalitis and so on, and all the regression syndromes that we see, you know, if you look at a child with Rett syndrome, for example, or even a kid with Landau-Kleffner, where you know there may be normal development up to a particular point of time, and then there is a regression. So the whole challenging area in developmental pediatrics of regression syndromes and neurodevelopmental conditions, some of which come under the autism spectrum, but may have degenerative conditions, and they have regression in the clinical pathways there. The last thing I want to point out before I get into the substance of what I want to share is, interestingly, something that Akbar said about mood disorder, which had been considered as a differential in this particular case there. Now, it is not that mood disorder cannot occur in children of preschool, but it is quite rare for mood disorders to occur in preschoolers, that is under the age of six. Baby bipolars are known, particularly if there's a very dense pedigree and a very dense family history of mood disorder there. So these are some fascinating issues that Akbar has raised, and I thought I would start with this, particularly when you deal with any kind of child who has an unusual presentation. In addition to all the other investigations, toxicology, this is a real takeaway message from this. Munchausen syndrome by proxy. Look at the three critical issues here. Unexplained, persistent, and puzzling symptoms should alert you for diagnosis. And the entire clinical process that this team and this incredibly professional team went through, you know, LP, blood tests, clinical observations, MRI, and so on. And yet, there was a past history of so many admissions. So in Munchausen syndrome by proxy, the presence of unexplained, persistent, and puzzling symptoms should alert you for the diagnosis. But more than that, more recently, the Royal College of Pediatrics and Childhood suggests a new nomenclature, and this is called factitious disorder imposed on another, or FDIA, which means that is fabricated or induced illness by the carers. What is very critical here is the Royal College of Pediatrics says shift the focus to child abuse that happens in medical settings. Now, this was not just if fictitious disorder or Munchausen by proxy, where caregivers or parents say, you know, the child has some rashes or, you know, or the child is not well. This is where tissue damage has been caused to the child externally and perhaps even internally when you look at the whole alcohol theme. They suggest that our focus should be to minimize harm to the child regardless of the motivation of the perpetrator. And, you know, as in many cases, perhaps in this, as Akbar will come in later to say, you know, were there financial and welfare considerations that really motivated this family to really create this kind of a scenario? Of course, ruling out the organic nature of the presenting symptoms is important, and how remarkably and how professionally this team has gone into every aspect of the differential diagnosis, and Akbar has presented that sequentially and beautifully. To repeat again, harm reduction remains to be the main aim, and child protection services and legal services have to be involved depending on the severity. So this is where increasingly, and this has been the iCancel mandate and the mandate of the network that I spoke about, that is the whole collaboration between pediatrics, between psychiatry, forensic, to gynecology, and child protection services and legal services. And this is going to, this has been in the past a challenge that we have faced, and increasingly going forward, this is a challenge we would need to face, particularly with the COVID situation, you know, and the lockdown. And if you look at the whole issue of social pediatrics and with daily wage workers and migrant workers, with loss of livelihood and loss of income, this is the time that child trafficking, child abuse, child marriage, all this is going to escalate. And as pediatricians, we really need to be alert to issues which are relevant to child protection services and to the legal services. Going ahead, factitious disorder imposed on another is a mental illness in which the person acts as if an individual he or she is caring for has a physical or a mental illness when the person is really not sick. Now, it is the adult perpetrator who has the diagnosis of factitious disorder imposed on another and directly produces, quote, lies, unquote, about the illness in another person under his or her care, usually a child. and usually under 6 years of age. And this is what is concerning. These are vulnerable children under the age of six. It is therefore considered a form of abuse by the American Professional Society on the abuse of children. And going ahead, I'm sure that the larger Indian Academy of Pediatrics body, as well as ICANSL, in their own advisories, will look at this as a form of abuse. You'll recall that in one of the slides that Akbar presented, he used the slide had a very fascinating title, Mimics and Chameleons. And you know, I have for you Hinterlands and Webs. As early as 1977, Lancet had produced a volume on hospital practice on Munchausen syndrome by proxy. And they called it the hinterland of child abuse. In Child Abuse and Neglect, which is the official journal of the American Society of Child Abuse and Neglect, 10 years later in 1987, look at the title, Web of Deceit, a literature on the review of Munchausen syndrome by proxy. So while you have mimics and chameleons, you also have hinterlands and webs. Let's try to link the presentation that Akbar made with the kind of presentation and issues that we speak of from Munchausen by proxy or factitious disorder imposed on another. The most common presentations of factitious disorder imposed on another are bleeding, seizures, central nervous system depression, apnea, diarrhea, vomiting, fever, rash, short-term morbidity 100%, long-term morbidity 8%. But note this, friends, mortality rate 9%. And I'm mentioning this for a very specific reason. One of your colleagues and a person deeply interested in the whole issue of child abuse, Preeti Galgali from Bangalore, who I think is present in this program. I recall mentioning to her about a child who had recurrent urinary tract infection, frequent visits to the pediatricians, antibiotics. It then transpired that there was a household help, a man. The child was not very well supervised. The parents had issues. The mother was not a very warm and caring person, attachment dynamics for. And this guy would constantly, his hygiene was very poor. He would constantly handle her genitalia, you know, with this. And that's how she got the, as she became an adolescent, the urinary tract infections became more severe, led to pyelonephritis, led to renal issues, leading to a state where she had to have unilateral one-sided nephrectomy. And the point I made to Preeti was, you know, organ loss is a very high price to pay for child sexual abuse. Similarly, mortality is a very high price to pay for a kid whose parent has factitious disorder imposed on another. We're talking about death here. A very quick point on serial Munchausen syndrome by proxy, where more than one child in the family is victimized. Now, the issue here is the high incidence of maternal psychiatric histories and marital difficulties and Munchausen syndrome in the mothers themselves. It is not that fathers do not have it, but the literature is characterized by high levels of pathology and psychiatric morbidity among the mothers. And this is something that we need to keep in mind. Continuing, primary uncomplicated cries for help. If a parent or parents bring a child to a pediatrician over a period of time again and again, you know, saying, with some symptoms, but they're not as serious as central nervous system depression, as it happened in this five-year-old child, and that to a child with a developmental disability of autism and speech delay, which was pre-existent. Now, these primary cries of help need to be differentiated from two major subtypes, the active inducer, as was the case here, and the doctor edict, which define the spectrum Munchausen syndrome by proxy. and these overlap with other harmful behavior of parents. The high incidence of pathology in perpetrators is leading to increasing concern about the safety of children. You know, and we don't know what happened. This child could have died. In the first episode of encephalopathy itself, when the child was deeply comatose. So children like this who are cared by parents, there are grave concerns about. To cap the whole thing, I want to share, which is a concern for all pediatricians engaged in child protection work, 5 core principles. Deception is present in all cases of factitious disorder imposed on another, and how therefore as pediatricians we need to keep in mind, other than the rigorous and professional pediatric investigations, examination and work that we need to do, that we also need to be aware of how this deception plays out. Second, individuals with underlying medical, psychiatric or developmental disorders may also be victims of FDI. This case is a case in point, a child with speech delay and autism. And these are particularly more vulnerable. Third, the identified victim is not the only victim of those with FDI. And therefore, to look at a larger family history and understand the background of the parents and their own families of origin, whether there's a transgenerational transmission or an intergenerational transmission of this kind of pathology. Layperson's beliefs about the nature of clinical decision-making can perpetuate Munchausen abuse, because of an assumption that this kind of stuff does not take place, just as it happened with child abuse 20, 25 years ago, when many of us started our work, what we call as the culture of denial and the conspiracy of silence. Child abuse does not occur in India. It's a Western phenomenon and so on. And, Munchausen or factitious disorder is an exotic thing. It is not. It's very much found here then. And it can be helpful to think of this abuse as some kind of a repetitive pattern, almost like an addiction that... So very intensive psychiatric evaluation, and social evaluation, and social investigating of the whole background on which this kind of a phenomena takes place is what we need to keep in mind. So this is what I wanted to share with you, ladies and gentlemen, to cap the fantastic presentation that Akbar had made. Over to you, Jason.
Thank you, Shekhar, for that excellent presentation. I have a few questions here. One is, what is the chance of, this child, there was a motive. I think Akbar did not say that, they were getting some money from a funding agency because the child was sick. And to continue to get the money that was happening, and as soon as the money decreased, the new abuse started. I mean, the burning this child and showing the child is sick. So this is something that perpetuated the abuse. So what is the other factors in the family that could make these parents do this?
Among the common factors that have been reported in the review of literature is particularly where vulnerable parents, mothers and fathers are concerned, the need to prove that they are caring parents, the whole notion where there is social pressure that, they are not caring enough. So one is the insecurity about how caring they are as. The second that literature says is about how there is a pathological need to basically prove to the medical fraternity of how deficient the medical fraternity is and therefore incapable of diagnosing thee. The third relates to clearly manipulative patterns of welfare benefits and other kinds of social benefits that taking a child to a hospital for consultation frequently actually accords to these families. The fourth is more serious forms of psychiatric illness in parents, particularly delusional disorders and other forms of serious mental illnesses. So there is a range here, ranging from severe mental illness on the one hand to manipulative social benefits and financial benefits on the other, to personality disorders where there is this kind of an interaction with the medical fraternity to prove some kind of superiority. And on the one hand, insecurities and anxieties about the role as a caregiver and a caretaker, and the need, therefore, to prove how caring and how concerned and how solicitous you are as a caregiver and a caretaker. Over to you, Jason.
Dr. Prithi Kalgali has asked, do these children need to be sent to foster care? Do they have to be separated from their parents? Did this happen in this child? No.
The issue depends on the severity of, and here is an instance where we were talking about issues of life and death. The problem is the deinstitutionalization debate in child protection circles is a contentious one. While there is a tendency to demonize institutions, particularly state-run institutions, to say how horrible they are, which is not fair because there are some state-run institutions which are very good. On the other hand, to say that the family is the best place and foster care and family placement and children should not be institutions may also not be fair to the child, particularly if the family is very abusive and neglectful. So this decision would have to be taken on a case-to-case basis. And in this case, obviously, we are dealing with very serious issues and fairly severe issues. And therefore, to really look at child protection and legal systems and to look at a caring place. And this is known, very well known in Munchausen. The moment the child is not with the parents or with some extended family, all the symptoms disappear. So this is the kind of framework with which I would look at this kind of an issue. Thanks, Preet.
Yeah, Dr. Akbar, was this child, we tried to put them into foster home, but it didn't work, isn't it? What happened? Dr. Akbar, are you here? Anyway, as far as I know, we couldn't get a foster. They went back to their home. The child was left back to the home. That's a system failure, isn't it? And we don't have follow up. We tried to contact them recently, but they were incommunicado. What is this system? I mean, is it a system failure in India?
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yes, of course. Well, you could call it a system failure, I suppose, that the moment an issue of this comes to notice, the social work systems, child protection systems, and legal systems need to come in place, but in a gentle and proactive way. The moment caretakers are frightened, the issue is not to take a retributive, punitive approach, outraged as we may be about this issue. So, and actually Dr. Himani has raised a very interesting issue in the chat itself. We don't know about more details about the family. A lot of these families live very isolated lives. They don't have an extended family. They don't have social supports. And what Dr. Himani is asking is, were there siblings?
There is a sibling.
Yeah,
so, a sibling who is also slightly, autistic, and we're not sure what has happened to that child either.
Yeah, so this is very concerning, and given the remarkable track record that Kerala has for contact tracing, thanks to Shailaja teacher and your remarkable IAS officer, I think this is the time that for families like this tracing is something that we really need to do, you know, for those who have, of us who are so interested in social pediatrics.
Dr. Swati Ghate has asked, do these parents need to be treated?
Absolutely. Absolutely. They need to be evaluated first. And this is the point that Akbar made when he quoted his teacher, Dr. Balakrishnan, from the psychiatrist, that, you know, for, you know, every neurological presentation, look for psychiatric issues. Every psychiatric issue, look for neurological. And look beyond that in a child to extended families. So these parents would have required intensive psychiatric and psychological assessment, and offered the treatment, you know, not to to vilify them or to label them, but to really offer treatment.
Okay, we'll go on to the quiz because we are short of time. I think I'll share the screen for the quiz. Priti and all of us who are there can always take part in this quiz. We're going to have a small quiz for all of you. I think Akbar, I hope you're there. Well, the first question is features of afebrile encephalopathy in children include all except acute or subacute onset, constellation of variable signs and symptoms. By far, the commonest cause in infection is autoimmune encephalitis. Unusual infections can be a cause of immunocompromised children. Iatrogenic cause of encephalopathy can occur without chemotherapy. I give you 10 seconds for the answers. Okay, we're going to the second question. All are true about non-convulsive seizures in children, except the non-convulsive seizures always occurs in children after a bout of overt seizures. Subtle clinical seizures can be noticed during spell of non-convulsive seizures. Non-convulsive seizures is more common among children with epilepsy than in normal children. And clinical clues to non-convulsive include myoclonic jerks around the mouth or extremities, abnormal breathing patterns, and spontaneous ocular nystagmus. All except. The third question is, all of the following are examples of treatable inherent metabolic disorders, except neurotransmitter disorders, paroxysm disorders, pyrotonic defect, and pyridoxine-dependent epilepsy. Inborn errors of metabolism, except one of these. He's done a lot about, told you a lot about Klein-Levin. So all are true about Klein-Levin syndrome, except childhood onset less than 12 years seen in 20% of cases. Hyperphagia is seen in all affected patients. Extremes of age onset leads to long persistence of somnolence episodes. And some patients with temporal lobe brain injury can show symptoms of KLS. Fifth question is, reasonable initial workup for a child with unexplained encephalopathy should include all except metabolic screening investigations to look for inborn errors of metabolism, the treatable inborn errors of metabolism, toxicology analysis of urine and blood, prolonged and continuous EEG rule out non-convulsive status epilepticus, genetic workup, including whole exome sequencing and mitochondrial sequencing. Sixth question is, the following are true about MSBP except presence of unexplained, persistent, or puzzling symptoms. Child protection services and legal services are not involved. Ruling out the organic nature of presenting symptoms is important, and it is important to minimize harm to the child. Next question is, common presentation of Munchausen syndrome by proxy include the following except bleeding, seizure and central nervous system depression, absence of motility, and frequent consultations. The last question is, the following are true about Munchausen syndrome by proxy. It is also called factitious disorder imposed on another. The adult perpetrator has the diagnosis. It occurs commonly in fathers. There is an overlap with other harmful behaviors of parents. Okay, I think we'll go through the answers now. I hope, Johnny, you have done the...
Yes.
You got the winner. Okay, yeah. Dr. Akbar, are you around?
Yes, sir, I'm around, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm
here. So this is the first question. Can you go through the first question?
Can we go through the answers?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the first question is, features of afebrile encephalopathy in children include all except... So as we know, there are two encephalopathy, febrile and afebrile encephalopathy. Febrile encephalopathy, we know the commonest cause would be infection. But when you have a child present with afebrile encephalopathy, you want to see for all except, does afebrile encephalopathy have acute or subacute symptoms? Yes, they can have acute or subacute constellation of symptoms. By far the commonest cause of children in autoimmune encephalitis? No. So afebrile encephalopathy to a child presenting to emergency or intensive care unit, we look for the common causes first. Among the common causes would include either metabolic or toxic causes. I think one key message that we got from our talk today is that, as Dr. Shekhar, as sir has rightly told, is that always think about simple urine and blood toxicological analysis. Okay, this could help us to exclude unusual encephalopathies presenting without fever. Autoimmune encephalitis, yes, is increasingly being recognized in children, but still the commonest cause of afebrile encephalopathy in children would be metabolic encephalopathies. A simple one would be just an hypoglycemia or a hyperammonemias. Unusual infections, yes, can be caused in immunocompromised children. They can present without fever. Iatrogenic causes can occur with chemotherapy. So many chemotherapeutic agents used in leukemias like methotrexate and other things can present with a encephalopathy. So the answer for question number one is option B. So by far the commonest cause in children is metabolic encephalopathies, but not autoimmune encephalopathy. So the next question, what is true about non-convulsive seizures in children is all except. So I had discussed about non-convulsive seizures. So it is important to know that non-convulsive seizures can happen in children without seizures also. Even though the commonest presentation of non-convulsive seizure is that After a convulsive status epilepticus episode, the child can be in an encephalopathy due to non-convulsive seizures. But non-convulsive seizures can also happen without clinical seizures, especially in children with a developmental delay or learning issues and in certain syndromes. So non-clinical seizures, subtle clinical seizures can be noticed in non-clinical seizures. I told this, you can have subtle myoclonic twitches, subtle eye movements like subtle nystagmus. Non-convulsive children is more common among children with epilepsy. Answer is yes. Non-convulsive status is more common among children with epilepsy than in a normal children. And there are clinical clues, of course, to a non-convulsive status. So the answer to this question is option number A. Non-convulsive status can also occur in children without overt clinical seizures. So the answer is option A. Next question. Question number three, sir. Next question. Yeah. So all of the following are examples of treatable IEM. Of course, I did not go too much into the concept of inborn error of metabolism, but generally the small molecule disorders are like amenable to treatment, like vitamin responsive conditions like biotin, thiamine, ammonia, fatty acid oxidation defects, etc. But if you look about the storage disorders like lysosomal or peroxisomal, they are not that much amenable to therapy. Whereas neurotransmitter disorders, some of them, for example, if a child presents with dystonia, dopamine-related disorders are very much treatable, like Segawa disease. So Segawa disease is treatable, neurotransmitter disorders is treatable, biotidinase defects is treatable, vitamin-responsive conditions like pyridoxine-dependent epilepsy is treatable. But storage disorders like lysosomal storage or peroxisomal storage disorders are not that much amenable to therapy. So the answer for this would be option number B. Peroxisomal disorders is not amenable to treatment. Question number four. All are true about Klein-Levin syndrome except. So I did discuss about Klein-Levin syndrome. I did told that it can happen in extremes of ages, like less than 10 years and more than 20 years. But it can be also be seen in elderly people. It can be seen after brain injury. I didn't say that, but it can be seen after temporal lobe brain injury, where there can be hyperorality, hypersexuality, and hypersomnolence syndrome. It can happen after temporal lobe epilepsy. So one interesting feature is that extremes of age, if the particular person has an onset of Klein-Levin syndrome, less than 10 years or about 20 years, they have more longer persistence of somnolence. The classical persistence of somnolence is usually somewhere between 10 to 15 years of somnolence. But if there's a very early onset or very late onset of KLS, the somnolence episodes tends to persist for a longer period of time. So C is also correct. A is also correct. Childhood onset less than 12 years is seen in around 20%. And more than 12 years is around 80% of the cases. So the answer is option B. So hyperphagia, hypersexuality, and hypersomnolence together, the classical triad is seen in only 50% of the cases. And hyperphagia alone is seen in only around 50 to 60% of the cases. Hyperphagia need not be seen in all affected patients. So if an affected patient with Klein-Levin has one of the syndrome of either confusion or derealization or apathy or hyperphagia or hypersexuality, we can clinically label it as probably Klein-Levin syndrome. So the answer for this question is option number B. Hyperphagia is not seen in all affected patients. Next question. Reasonable workup. I think the fifth question is the theme of what we were discussing, and rightly as Dr. Shekhar mentioned about Muzaffarpur cases and so and so. So toxicological analysis should be included in any unexplained encephalopathies. For our child, I was a little bit swayed by the opinion that the child is presenting with a recurring bouts of encephalopathy. So a recurrent toxic intoxication or recurrent ingestion was not in my mind to begin with. So for this child, probably yes, urine toxic analysis should be done in every child with unexplained encephalopathies. And metabolic screening investigations should be done to look for treatable IEM disorders. That's correct. Prolonged and continuous EEG should be done to rule out non-convulsive status epilepticus. That is correct. So genetic workup and whole exome is not done at the onset. Of course, you would give enough time for you to reanalyze the case again and again with multiple revisits. And then if further initial screening investigations are negative, then we can think about rare genetic causes like channelopathies. So the option for this would be for initial workup of the child, all could be done except a genetic workup. Option number D is the answer for this particular question. I think. Thank you,
Dr. Akbar.
Yes, sir.
Now we'll go on to Shekhar, the next question.
Thank you very much, Akbar. Just taking over from what you said about the importance of toxicology, I'm just wondering whether going ahead in the area of pediatric neurology, particularly for these kind of syndromes, whether urine screen for toxicology could be included as an SOP, just for you guys to consider
that. Yes, sir. Agree with that. Like any unexplained encephalopathy, we should go for a urine and toxicologic analysis. But right. The recurring bouts and was the thing, probably I thought it's more of an inborn error of metabolism rather than toxin. So yes, toxin and metabolism are should be considered to be together rather than, you know, should not be separated. I agree with that fact, yeah.
So, you know, if you look at really this factitious disorder imposed on another,
yeah,
you see here that the whole context of presenting it in the pediatric potpourri was that how rigorous clinical approach is important, and that's what, you know, Akbar has presented. But the fact that the harm to the child and, you know, the extreme of harm, which is mortality, and we should concern ourselves, particularly when we have unexplained persistent
systems
in mind.
Yes, so all the three things would typically fit: unexplained, persistent, and puzzling symptoms. Agree.
So child protection services and legal systems need to be involved the moment you have an index of suspicion, either through history or through investigation. The earlier you involve these services, the chances, for example, with this family, that they would be lost to follow-up would not take place, and how do we trace the family. So that's the lesson we learn from here. If you go to the next one, can we go to the next one, please? Yeah. So the common features, like I have mentioned, this case is a clear exemplification of central nervous system depression. Frequent consultation, so many times the child came, and of course bleeding issues, rashes, we've spoken about a lot of that. And I particularly, so obviously mortality is there, you know, to the extent of 9 to 10%. And this is something that we should concern ourselves about. This was really to alert yourselves if we could lose our children in the context of these, the hinterlands of child abuse, if you're not alert to the whole Munchausen phenomena. Next one. Well, yes, it is called, this is the new term, DSM-5, factitious disorder imposed on another. It is the adult perpetrator who has the diagnosis. It is commonly overlapping with other harmful behaviors. Therefore, a good history about child abuse, a good history about the background of the parents, their own childhood, how socially networked are they or isolated, calling for a psychiatric consultation would be important. This is very curious. Why does it occur more in mothers than in fathers? And this is a question that has not really been satisfactorily answered. And this is really an area of research that I think the psychiatric fraternity needs to go into in collaboration with the pediatric fraternity. And this is a fertile area for future research. Over to you, Jason.
Yeah, I'd now want Dr. Akbar and Dr. Shekhar to say their last, what are the message that you'd like to give, Akbar first?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, it's interesting to keep an open mind and continue to learn, which I understood from my many teachers. And it's important probably not to come to a conclusion very fast. And as rightly said, if you have unusual symptoms, always think about the other aspect of neuroscience, the mind and the other psychiatric conditions. Yeah. So this would be my message for me. I think we continue to keep open mind and continue to keep the differentials diagnosis open rather than closing a diagnosis, so that we continue to work up and you observe and monitor the children and the family together. Yeah. The message is, of course, is very keen from the other aspect, what Dr. Shekhar said. Everything is absolutely, I agree with that. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Shekhar. Your wise last comments.
Yes.
I don't know how wise. Number one, I don't think this is as rare or as exotic as we think it is. We have probably missed a lot of cases.
Right.
Second, toxicology screen, urine screen. as an SOP for any muscling encephalopathy as an SOP, right? And because it's a urine thing, you know, it's not invasive.
It's
not expensive, relatively speaking.
Right.
Third, collaboration between pediatrics and psychiatry to examine this. And for social pediatrics and its collaboration with child protection services,
going forward, beginning.
Be a major area in pediatric training and pediatric practice.
Thank you so much.